In the rest of the world, we've actually had great reception to the film. Just 2 weeks ago, I won the Women in Film Award in Los Angeles, which the Women in Film Organization is trying to get more female filmmakers and writers and producers behind the camera. We've had a lot of success in other countries, so Australia is really the only place that we've had protests and petitions and bannings like this.
Do you have an understanding as to why those protests are there?
I do not. This is my first time visiting Australia. I'm curious what is different about Australia that makes this topic so polarizing and so fearful to people that they actually want to shut it down and silence it and pull it from theaters. I'm not sure why there's so much resistance in Australia.
Cassie, I think it could be to do with the fact that a couple of years ago, our Australian of the Year was a mum who lost her only son at the hands of his father in a domestic violence incident. One woman is killed every week at the hands of domestic violence. It's really on the agenda here in Australia. It's not tolerated, and we're really trying to move forward and get on a path where women aren't dying. I think that is why your film has hit a nerve.
And it was her son that passed?
It was her son who was killed by his father.
I didn't know about that, but that is interesting because it shows that there are male victims of domestic violence.
Sorry, that's the lesson you took from that? Because children are always factored into the domestic violence conversation. The point that I think a lot of people take from that is that the violence was perpetrated by a man in that situation, as it overwhelmingly is, particularly in cases where there's a fatality.
That this is a very, you know, touchy subject that does, you know, can quickly offend people, so I'll use my words wisely, but it's something that I really thought long and hard about while I was making The Red Pill. Where I've come today after 4 years of working on The Red Pill is that we have to distinguish between victims and perpetrators or criminals or the evil people in the world, because, you know, a boy who is being abused by a parental figure, that is a boy that deserves care and compassion and resources if he needs to find help. And so I'm not sure about in Australia, but in the U.S. we only have one domestic violence shelter that accepts male victims and over 2,000 for female victims.
In the movie, you start by Googling rape culture, but you don't seem to sort of touch on that again. And even when you speak to Paul Ellum, who, you know, claims that women want to be raped, and he said many other highly offensive things, you don't seem to ask him about that. Why didn't you ask him about that?
I did ask them about that. I have 100 hours of footage, and the film is 2 hours long, so a lot hit the cutting room floor, and I do plan on releasing all the footage that I gathered. But of course, I asked all of those questions. I spent at least 2 hours with each person I interviewed, but the longest was 8 hours. And a lot of the comments, if taken in context, have explanations for why they said those things that do come off, you know, off-putting or offensive in some ways. And you know, oftentimes it's either satire or they're trying to make a point that, you know, if the genders were reversed, this wouldn't be acceptable.
But Cassie, don't you think viewers deserve to see what some of those answers on rape culture were?
You know, I edited the film, and I include a lot of topics in the film that I hope when people see the film they want to talk about what is included in the film rather than what was left out, because there was a lot included. The reason I chose to leave out or not go back to the rape culture discussion is because you really can't put 10 minutes into this film about rape culture and have it be complete. It is such a deep rabbit hole, and I think it deserves its own film entirely.
There are valid arguments that you raise, particularly regarding the court rulings and male suicide, but don't you think that you undermine all that by making sweeping arguments about how both genders suffer in a similar way from domestic violence? I mean, aren't generalizations like that dangerous?
I definitely believe that generalizing is dangerous, and we see that very often with female rights advocates. I did leave feminism after making this film because I saw feminism as having blinders on, that they only focused on women's issues and, you know, girls' issues. A men's rights activist would say, well, here are all the men's rights issues. And I, as a feminist, would want to say, but what about women? We've got to look at women. And men's rights activists would respond by saying, we do look at women. Can we talk about men here? This is just a conversation where we want to talk about men and boys' problems for just 5 minutes.
All right, Cassie, we're out of time. We'll have to leave it there, but thank you very much for joining us.
Thanks for having me.